Brijesh sir, shall I start?
Yes, please. Yes, sir, please start the meeting. Yes, sir, please start.
Okay, thank you, sir. So, good morning to all my friends, respected teachers, industry persons, on the eve of Engineering Day, we are organized the one day workshop by jointly Bharel University and Jia Process Engineering Private Limited. So, the national level online workshop on recent advances in dairy and food engineering. So, my dear friends, Department of Dairy So, we are really fortunate to have the Provost of Bharel University, Dr. M.N. Patel, sir, and the Honorable Registrar, Dr. H.S. Vijay Kumar, sir. I welcome the Provost, sir, and Registrar, sir, for the workshop, as well as the respected Principal of PIT, Dr. Bhavesh Mevada, sir, is with us. So, firstly, I will give brief for the workshop. Sir, today we have the technical four sessions. The first session expert is Mr. Rajesh Golani. He is from Gia Process Engineering Private Limited. Dr. Chitranayak, sir, is a senior scientist, Dairy Engineering Division, Indian Council of Agriculture Research, National Dairy Research Institute, India. I welcome the both of the experts for the first technical session, first and second, and the third technical session delivered by the Ms. Swati Singh, the manager sales, Jia Process Engineering. A topic about advanced technology solution for liquid milk processing and value-added products in dairy segments. So I welcome the Swati ma'am and the last expert, Mr. So, as per the participation concern, so respected sirs, today's workshop. This is the one achievement for us, and now I request to Honorable Provost sir, please address the audience.
Professor Kele, I am audible. Hello, Professor Kele, I am audible or not?
Yes, sir, clearly, sir.
Clearly. Thank you very much. First, I congratulate especially a small department is also arranging such a big or a large seminar, webinar. I'm seeing that the participants are more than 500. It's really a great pleasure. and it is only possible the effort taken by the Professor Kele, and we have got a very good stalwarts on this occasion to speak so that the good audience is there. No doubt we are running so many faculty, and this where our best, or the, we can consider the stalwart engineer of the India, Mr. Vishwesharaiya, whose birthday is celebrated as Engineers Day, and so many stories are associated with that, and he has contributed a lot, especially in civil engineering, Krishna Sagar Dam, and so many irrigation scheme which he has promoted, and by which we are became, especially in irrigation and in food technology, supported by that, we are became rather self-sufficient. When we became independence, we were very, very dependent to other, because food was not that much we are producing or not we are distributing properly. But day by day, the technology developed, and we have learned more, lot from all each other. And obviously now we are self-sustained. And as so far, we are producing all the foods and whatever the needs of a human being. At least we can say that, which we are producing at our country. And nowadays it is a time of food processing, where we are producing a lot, but the processing part is still lacking. Because I visited last year Netherlands, and I've seen that the food processing part at the university was very much taken care. If that part is more taken care, then obviously whatever we are producing, then effectively that can be served to the society without the wasting of that. And I think this type of seminar where the expert have a knowledge of different area of food processing, and so we to my participant and my department to have this type of webinar on the day of Engineers Day, on the occasion of Engineers Day. It became a privilege for me to be the part of that. So my best wishes to all of you. Over to Professor Kele.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I request to Registrar of the Paris University, Honorable Dr. H.S. Vijay Kumar, sir, please address the audience.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kele. Namaskar to everyone, the respected panelists, all the participants who are more than 500 in number, as I can see here. And I'm sure on YouTube also there are many. Dr. Kele tells me that there are more than 2,400 applications. Am I audible, Kele? Kele, am I audible? There is some problem with the internet connection perhaps. Hello?
Sir, you are audible.
Okay. So it's very encouraging that, as the provost rightly said, this being a small department, but they are very active in arranging all the workshops, seminars, training programs. And today's program, I'm told that there are 2,400 applicants who have registered already for this. They come from across all the 28 states and 5 union territories. Not only this, there are also registering participants from 16 other countries. Sir, my felicitations to you, not only for this achievement, which can I?
Hello. 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 So, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Am I audible?
Will yes, yes.
Because there is some problem with the internet connection.
Yes, sir.
All the best. Good luck to all the participants. My respects to all the panelists who are here, experts who are going to give them the workshop, the complete lead and the direction of what the workshop should take. All the very best, Dr. Kele, and your team, and good luck to all the participants. Please go ahead.
Connectivity problem. Hello. Sorry for inconvenience. There is a little bit internet connectivity problem. So now I request to respected Bhavesh Mevada sir, please address the audience. Dr. Bhavesh Mevada sir. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes. Hello.
Yes. So now I request to Dr. Bhavesh Mevada, sir, Principal PID, please address the participant.
Okay. Thank you, Kele, sir. Wish you all a happy Engineers Day, and thanks a lot to our professor and registrar, sir, for giving their blessings. And I welcome the guest experts for this today's sessions. And on behalf of, I can say, in today's coming era, at the same time, because we are facing a lot of challenges also. And for to cope up with those challenges, we have to go for digitization or something you can advancement in the regular technologies what we have in food industries. And as we know that GE is one of the company who is always a leader in the latest technology adopting for the food industry. We are lucky enough to have their plant in very I think due to unstable connections, disconnecting. So yes, Kele sir, you can go ahead with your regular program and you can invite the expert and start the talk. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, thank you very much, Honorable Professor Parul University. Thanks, Honorable Registrar, sir. Parul University, Dr. H.S. Vijay Kumar, sir. Thank you, respected Bhavesh Mevada, sir, Principal PIT, for the best wishes for the programs. Thank you very much. Now I introduce the technical experts for the technical session 1 Dr. Rajesh Gulani sir. He sir has completed their bachelor in chemical engineering.
Hello, the audio is not there.
Hello.
Dr. Kelly, the audio was not there for last 2-3
minutes. Yes, sir. There is a little bit problem with the internet connectivity. I don't know why it will happen. Okay. So, project management at meal powder plants, business head of food drying system, and now he's a head of sales support and office management liquid powders technology division for various application in dairy, foods and chemicals. So I welcome to Mr. Rajesh Gulani sir. Sir, I will hand over the session to you for the presentation. Yeah. Mr. Rajesh Gulani sir.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes sir, please.
Okay. So good morning to everybody, and wish you a very, very happy Engineers Day. Respected and honorable Dr. M.N. Patel, Dr. H.S. Vijay Kumar, Dr. Mevada, Dr. Kele, and the entire Parul University management team. I am thankful to you for giving GIA Process Engineering a platform to participate in this webinar. So what I will do, because I heard that there are a lot of audio problems, so I will switch off my video, as I'm operating from home, so I will switch off my video so that there are no interruptions in the audio, and I will also share my screen. And Dr. Kelly, please tell me if the audio disappears in between.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Yeah. Can you see my screen, please?
Yes, sir. Visible, sir. No problem.
Okay. So in between, if there is a interruption, either in audio or visual, please let me know. So this is, basically, I will touch base upon, the milk powder technology. And of course, it is a very complex subject, and it's very difficult to, put everything together in 45 minutes, 1 hour. So I will try my level best to give important, salient features as well as the innovations, which are there in milk powder industry. Before that, I just wanted to give a background that despite apprehensions, for the production of buffalo milk powder, India's first spray dryer was commissioned successfully at Amul Dairy in 1950s, mid-50s. It was a small and single stage spray dryer with capacity of around 6 tons per day. And it was imported from Kia Nairo, Denmark, but today after almost 6 decades, we have now large and modern automated powder plants of huge capacities now, like 100 tons per day, 150 tons per day, 60 tons per day, and producing agglomerated and instant powders, whether it is SMP, baby food, dairy whitener with the high sugar content, 18 to 20%, which is of course unique for India. Demineralized whey powder, which is quite tricky because of its hygroscopic nature. So during this journey of 6 decades, the powder plant technology, along with the feedback and experience from the dairies, have really come off of the age and has really evolved, and now is in process of graduating to the next generation level. Having said that, The powder plant operation continues to be a complex with a lot of interdependencies on multitude of factors, be it the ambient conditions, which keep on changing every day, milk properties, different milk properties and qualities all over India, powder properties, hygiene and safety. And thus it is a need of the hour to be always at the forefront of the continued innovation in the technology, as in India continues to be the large producer of milk. In fact, it's the largest producer of milk in the world. So first, a few slides on what GIA is. Of course, the theme here is, engineering for change, and GIA stands with the same philosophy. It is engineering for change for a better world. GIA is one of the largest suppliers of process technology to the food and dairy sector. Then apart from food and dairy, it is pharma, chemicals, utilities, and we are close to around 19,000 employees. Our sales is close to around 4.8 billion euro. And the company is in public domain. It is listed on German stock exchanges. So if you see, how our technologies, they touch touch human lives, every day. When we talk about dairy farming and processing, approximately 1/4 of the processed milk, it is processed through GIA plants. Of course, now it is the era of vegans, but even for non-veg, every third chicken nugget is produced using GIA technology. Every third process line for instant coffee has been installed by GIA. It is a dry state, but every second liter of beer is also brewed with GIA technology. Then we also cater to the pharma industry. Every fourth liter of human blood, for making this plasma-derived products is processed using GIA equipment. In chemical field, more than 1/3 of all polymer producers, they are using GIA drying technology. And plus, we also cater to utilities in marine. Coming to the dairy sector, the entire spectrum of dairy technologies we have, right from the liquid milk processing, the value-added products, the fat products like ghee and anhydrous milk fat. Then we also have, the cheese, the mozzarella cheese, and also the different types of yogurts like Greek-style yogurt. on right hand sides you can see, you know, dairy powders and nutritional formulas. So we have you know, we have set up plants, we have technologies in house for production of milk powders, whether it's a baby food, whether it's a whole milk powder, skim milk powder, dairy whitener, and also the dairy ingredients, you know, which are becoming quite popular in today's time. And the whey protein concentrate powders, the WPIs, the lactose. So we'll start with an overview of a milk powder factory, you know, and I will touch upon, you know, milk evaporation technology, the spray drying technology, powder handling systems, and the packing lines, you know. So all these are very important, you know, critical building blocks of a milk powder factory. And if you see, you know, some of the dairy powders which are available in the market, like dairy whitener we have, which is a sugar formulated milk powder with around 20% sugar and 20% fat. We have infant milk formula where it is formulated with vitamins and other, you know, whey proteins. Then skim milk powder is there, which is having very less fat. Nutritional powders, again formulated, the base powder still remains the spray dried milk powder, but then you keep on formulating, you know, with more vitamins, minerals, you know, to make it nutritional powders. And then we also have whey protein powders, you know, and in today's era, you know, where everybody is so conscious about their health, you know, this whey protein powders are quite becoming popular. Am I audible and visible, Dr. Kele?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is a typical milk powder factory, and you know, we get pasteurized milk from the liquid milk processing plant. In fact, in the second session, you know, my colleague Swati Singh will touch upon on the liquid milk processing and the value-added products. So we get pasteurized milk from the liquid milk processing plant, that is a feedstock to the milk powder factory. The first step is, you know, the evaporation plant, which concentrates the milk, you know, from the initial TS. It depends, you know, if it is a skim milk, then it is 8.5% TS, typically. If it is a dairy whitener, which is sugar formulated, it is around 14% TS. And if it is a whole milk, you know, it is 12% TS. So this milk has a lot of water, and the water is removed in this evaporation plant, and it is concentrated to around 48% TS, right? The cost of water removal is more cheaper in evaporation plant rather than the spray dryer. So we concentrate, you know, the milk to around 48% TS. And then it is taken to the spray drying plant for production of the powder. And from the spray dryer, you know, the powder is quite agglomerated, you know, because you need to go for superior agglomeration for better instant properties. And that's where, you know, you need to handle the powder very gently so that the agglomeration doesn't break down. So we have a specialized, you know, dense phase powder conveying system, which transports the powder from the spray dryer to the powder silos. And from powder silos, it goes to the packing line, you know, which is also automated, you know, hygienic packing line, you know. So this is how, you know, the milk powder factory is, right from the milk to the packing of the powder. So this is how it looks, you know, as a 3D modeling, like, you know, we have, if you see this, an overview of powder plant, we have this milk silos, which is holding the pasteurized milk from the liquid milk plant. Then these are all tankages, you know, for CIPs and other things. We have this MVR based evaporation plant. There's a spray dryer over there. The exhaust recovery is through the back filter, and then you've got the powder silos, you know. But what I will do, I will run a film, you know, which, you know, for a milk powder plant, which we have set up at Amul Fat Dairy, And before we go into nitty-gritty of technical slides, you know, I would like audience to see this film, which is around 3.5 minutes. So now, you know, having seen this film, you know, this is, you know, the largest milk powder plant with capacity of 150 tons per day. So it means that, you know, the production rate is close to around 7,500 kgs per hour, you know. On skim milk powder, the plant is run, when it is run for 20 hours for skim milk powder. But also the plant is designed for dairy whitener and it can run 24/7, you know, and it has a two sets of evaporation plants, two sets of the feed system, and a very, very large multi-stage dryer, followed by cyclones, as well as, you know, the back filter. So now we come to the milk evaporation technology. Am I audible and visible, Dr. Kele?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, okay. Sir. Carry on. Carry on.
Okay. Thank you. So evaporation plant is very critical, of course it removes the water and concentrates the milk, you know, but a lot of powder properties are set in the evaporation plant, you know, like solubility, WPNI index, instant properties, as well as the coffee test stability. And especially now, you know, there's more awareness of the bacteriology, you know, bacterial spores which are developed in the evaporator. If it is, the design, the heat treatment is not proper, it also affects the final powder quality. And as I told you that, you know, the cost of water removal is much less in evaporation plant. In evaporation plant, we have, if you talk about the steam economy, depending upon the number of effects, you know, it is close to around 0.13 to 0.2, you know, whereas, the energy requirement for the spray dryer is almost, 15 times more, So always the objective is, always to, increase the TS, increase the solid contents from the evaporation plant to the extent possible. If you see the history, earlier it was, 41 to 42% TS, then it increased to 45% TS. And now, we have at least, 50% TS for the dairy whitener milk. And for skim milk, we still restrict to around 48% TS because it becomes quite viscous, because of absence of fat. So the evaporation plant also has to be designed properly, hygienically designed, because even the best dryer in the world will be not successful to make a good powder, out of bad concentrate. So this is more of a, many students are also in the audience, this is, basic single effect evaporator without TVR, and we'll come subsequently to, thermal vapor recompression and the mechanical vapor recompression. But here, milk is a heat sensitive product, because of its protein content. And everybody knows that, if I want to evaporate, if I want to remove the water at 100 degrees centigrade, it will result into denaturation of proteins, So the boiling section is always operated under the vacuum, which means that the boiling and the evaporation, takes place at lower temperature than that corresponding to the normal atmospheric pressure. So in a single effect evaporation plant, 1 kg of steam gives 1 kg of evaporation. Now, this is a 5-effect evaporation plant. It is without TVR. And normally this is an industrial installation. And a very important factor, when we design the evaporation plant is a selection of boiling temperature throughout the whole evaporation plant, And as I told you, milk is a heat sensitive liquid to prevent fouling, because of micro thin deposits of mainly milk proteins on tubes and crystallization of calcium phosphates at high temperature. Thus the maximum permissible boiling temperature in the first effect is typically kept at 66 to 68 degrees centigrade. As you increase the concentration during evaporation, the viscosity of the concentrate also increases. This increase is supported by the temperature drop, and hence there is also limit for the minimal permissible temperature. So total delta, between the first effect and the last effect is in the range of 18 to 19 degrees centigrade, and it is divided between each effect, So here, by the same analogy, we had single effect in our previous slide. So 1 kg steam in this case will give 5 kg of evaporation. Now, when we talk about thermocompressor, and we have to increase the efficiency of the evaporation plant, and also, increase the steam economy. So one way of saving energy is by using a thermocompressor, which increases the pressure and temperature level of the vapor being said, it compresses the vapor from the lower pressure to the higher pressure by using steam of higher pressure. So here you can see, you know, 2 kg vapor is sucked into a stream of 1 kg steam at higher pressure, and then you get around 3 kg vapor at 70 degrees centigrade. Thermocompressors, they operate at high steam flow velocities and have no moving parts. So this is a very simple construction. In many of the industrial scale plants, you know, you have this thermal vapor recompression to improve the steam economy of the evaporation plant. So if I install thermocompressor, in this case, a 4-effect evaporation plant, my 1 kg of steam will give 8 kg of evaporation, right? And without thermocompressor, you know, it would have given me only 4 kg of evaporation. So in nutshell, you know, thermocompressors, they improve the efficiency of evaporation plant. Typically, they are limited to temperature rise of around 20 degrees centigrade. In practice, they operate over 1 to 3 effects. The pickup ratio for the vapor. Am I audible now? Hello? Dr. Kele, please monitor my audio and visio. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, clearly. Very clear.
Okay. No problem. Yeah, in between there are some, like recording has stopped and started, so I'm not sure, you know, whether my connectivity is consistent. Yeah.
Okay. No, sir, very clear presentation, no problem, sir.
Okay.
Continue, sir.
Yeah, so the pickup ratio of the vapor is between 0.8 to 2.2, that is, you know, per kg of steam. And of course, this is all dependent on the temperature rise required. Higher the temperature rise, the lower the pickup ratio. Only a part of the vapor produced is recompressed. And a thermocompressor is a constant volume device. Thus, the suction temperature influences the mass of the vapor, which is recompressed. On the alternative to TVR is mechanical vapor recompression, and this is also gaining a lot of popularity, you know, over last 30 years, and especially, you know, for the large powder plants, you know, instead of using steam, you know, we use power, and has found extensive use in the evaporators in the dairy industries. And for all our large plants like 100 tons per day, 150 tons per day, and even 30 tons per day, depending upon the utility cost, you know, we have given this mechanical vapor recompression. Now, what does it does? You know, the MVR is a fast revolving high pressure fan capable of operating under vacuum. And this is how it compresses the vapor, you know. The only thing unique about this MVR is that, you know, the delta T is only 5 degrees centigrade, you know, because at the low boiling temperatures, the volume of vapor is quite large, you know. So consequently, there's a limit as to the lowest temperature levels used in practice. So therefore, it is essential to operate a MVR unit at a low temperature difference between the vapor evolved from the product and the heating medium. And always, you know, MVR evaporator is combined with a TVR unit, you know, to achieve around 40 to 50% TS. So in practice, you know, the MVR evaporator concentrates the milk up to 40% TS, and from 40 to 48% TS is done by a downstream small TVR based evaporation plant. So this is what I told, that as the concentration level increases, you know, your boiling point elevation is also increasing, you know. So this is an example that for a skim milk unit, 40% TS, it is 0.87 degrees centigrade, and at 50% TS, it is 1.41 degrees centigrade. So it is almost 28% of the available temperature rise of 5 degrees centigrade, you know. So that's where the pressure drop is very, very important in MVR calendrias. Normally, you know, the vapor separators are integral at the bottom of the calendrias so that the pressure drop is minimal. You know. So this is how it looks like. You know, we have a preheating section where the milk is heated to around 75-80 degrees centigrade. It goes to the MBR evaporation plant. You can see the multipass design is there, you know, to ensure proper wetting rates. And then it is followed by a small TVR evaporation plant. So when we talk about comparison between TVR and MVR, it is of course governed by the local cost of energy. Difference of price between MVR and TVR plants decreases as the size increases. That's what I told, that in large plants, MVR becomes an obvious choice because of higher evaporation capacities. And of course, the evaporator lasts for minimum 25 years. In fact, some of our plants are running for almost 40 years, in India. So we should not focus on the initial investment, especially, when MVR evaporation plant is concerned, because it involves expensive, MVR fan, which is imported from Europe. And also, we should also keep it in mind, what is the future evolution of the energy cost while making a decision between TVR and MVR. The vapor separators, for TVR based evaporation plants, we have tangential vapor separators, all hygienically designed, no flanges or baffle plates, circular ducts, ducts as short as possible. And for MVR based evaporation plants, we have got wrap around separators, there is a little bit of microbiology also involved in the milk application, and as the incoming milk of the temperature, the incoming milk has a temperature of around 5 to 10 degrees centigrade. It comes from the liquid milk plant, and then it has to be preheated, to more than the boiling temperature. Before it goes to the first effect evaporation plant for flashing and to enable evaporation. However, the large surface of the preheaters and the temperature level prevailing during the operation, if it is, say 5 to 70 degrees centigrade, the preheating range. So it is, it becomes a optimal growth conditions of mesophiles and thermophiles bacteria, And if you see, the evaporation plant with the preheater, which offers a heating surface, for bacteria to grow, after 10 to 16 hours of operation, a biofilm is formed, on the inner surface of the preheaters, where they can form the spores. So this is how, the biofilm is produced on the preheater surface, which is a metical surface in that preheating range, So one is, the first step is the transport, the addition, the growth polymerization, and then a biofilm is produced, on the metallic surface. And that happens, maybe after 10 to 15 hours of the evaporation plant. But the challenge here is, we need to run the evaporation plant for 20 hours, so here, from the biofilms, these are all vegetative cells, and if it is any lack of nutrition in this biofilms, the spores, they are released, they are formed, and then they are released in the milk, which is an undesirable situation, So in the recent years, the presence of thermophilic bacteria and their spores in milk powder has become a challenging problem, for powder manufacturers. Thermophiles, they are spore forming bacteria. It means that during adverse environmental conditions, they form a thick coat outside their cellular body and they lie dormant, And this also provides them a protective shield from the hostile environment. As soon as the favorable conditions return, they emerge out of the coat, grow, regenerate again like the vegetative cells. Although thermophilic spores are not really pathogenic, but their presence in milk and milk powder, gives an indication of the hygienic situation of the evaporation plant, such as design, general management practice, cleaning regime. There is no legislation as of now, but now more and more customers are simply refusing the powder with high thermophilic spore counts, and these limits are getting more and more stringent, and especially when we talk about this nutritional formulas and baby food powders. So what we do, like, you know, in our design, instead of going for a tubular preheater, we go for a direct contact preheater where the milk from 45 degrees centigrade to 70 degrees centigrade, you know, which is the ideal range for growth of thermophilic bacteria, it gets heated in fraction of time, you know, and thus we avoid giving any metallic surface area for bacteria to grow, you know, for vegetative cells to form a biofilm. So in the latest industrial installations, we have direct contact preheaters, say from 5 to 45, again a direct contact preheater to avoid any mesophilic growth, and then from 45 to 70 degrees centigrade, again a direct contact preheater, you know. So this is, you know, in the earlier designs, in the old designs, you know, there were preheaters, which were all tubular preheaters, and now they have been replaced with this direct contact preheaters, you know, to avoid, to eliminate the, or I would say to minimize the growth of vegetative cells and spores. So that completes the evaporation plant, which is the initial step of milk powder production. We go to the spray drying technology. So the spray drying of the product, you know, it involves the atomization, you know, and atomization is like, you know, you convert liquid feed into spray, into spray of droplets, you know, to increase the surface area, you know, for faster evaporation and drying. The second step is, you know, spray air contact, which is, you know, you're introducing the atomized feed into hot air, which is again, you know, mixing and flow patterns. Again, there is a science and technology involved here. And then you dry the spray droplets, which is, you know, very, very rapid evaporation due to the large surface area of the droplets. So the thermal load on the product will be low. And then, you know, whatever is the exhaust air, you need to recover the product, you know, either through cyclones or back filter. And then, you know, again, you put the same fines into the systems for increasing the agglomeration. And at the same time, you know, whatever the emission losses are there to the atmosphere, you minimize that, you know. So in terms of engineering, you know, the drying of the product involves, first is the heat transfer to the surface of the product. Then there is a evaporation from the surface of the product. And then again, there is a process called diffusion, you know, which is involved where there is a transport of water from the interior of the product to the surface, you know, and then mixing and removal of the evaporative water from the particles with the drying air. So there are great changes in the properties of the drying product and the drying air. And that's where, you know, the spray drying operation is quite complex, you know. I will just run a short film, you know, at least it will show you some animation, you know, what happens in the inside of the spray dryer. Okay, so can you please hear me, please? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are.
Okay. So, you know, how the spread has evolved, you know, over last 50 years. If you see, you know, in 1960s, you know, we have we had this single stage spray dryer where, you know, the complete moisture removal was taking place in the chamber itself. As a result, you know, the exhaust air and the particle temperature was much higher coming out of the spray dryer. And then we had this cyclone fraction and the chamber fraction being conveyed to the conveying cyclone. And from there, the powder was collected, you know. So it was a spray dryer, a single stage spray dryer with pneumatic transport. That was in 1960s. Then in 1970s and 80s, you know, it was a two-stage dryer, I would say. So it means that, you know, you allow a little bit more moisture to come out from the spray dryer. And the residual moisture you remove in the vibrofluidizer, which is a second drying stage. Whatever is the powder collected from the cyclones is again taken back to the atomizing zone for production of the agglomerated powders. So that was, you know, in the 1970s and 80s, where we have a two-stage dryers and the fines written, you know, being taken to the process. And in early 90s to 2000, you know, we had this tall form dryer. This was also a two-stage dryer. And it featured nozzle atomizer. And then again, you know, we can see that there was a transition from rotary atomizer to the nozzle atomizer. And the nozzle atomizer is widely used in dairy industry for its benefits, I would say, you know, and I will come to the next slide, the difference between nozzle atomizer and the rotary atomizer. So here in the tall form dryer, you know, the air outlet was through the bustle, which was between chamber and the cone, you can see here. And there was no duct for the exhaust air, you know, unlike in this single stage dryers with rotary atomizer, there was a duct which was inside the cone. Here there was no duct directly, you know, the air was exhausted through the buzzers. And now from 2006 onwards, you know, the multi-stage dryer is there, which is a three-stage drying systems. And here you can see the geometry of the chamber, the airflow patterns, the hot air is also from the top, whereas the exhaust air is also, you know, is exhausted from the top. And this is, I would say, it's a three-stage drying system because there is a static fluid bed, which is a secondary drying stage as an integral part of the chamber, and then vibrofluidizer. So this dryer is very much popular because of its benefits. It gives a very superior agglomeration. Higher the agglomeration, better is the instant property. It is very good in thermal efficiencies. It can operate at higher inlet temperature, which means that, you know, I can get more capacity from the dryer, and it operates at lower exhaust temperature. So the delta T is much higher, which means that, you know, the thermal efficiency is much more in this three-stage dryer. So before we go to the multi-stage dryer, you know, we have this different types of atomization, the rotary atomization, which was very, very popular for milk powder. In fact, you know, the spray drying technology started with rotary atomizer, easy to operate, and it has low wear and tear, and it is an air pump, so it whips air into the concentrate. Then the shift was towards the nozzle atomizer, where it was found that the flowability of the powder is much better. And then there is a lot of flexibility of you know, orientation of nozzles. You know, if you want powders with different bulk densities and different particle size, you know, then nozzle atomizer was more versatile. You know, it doesn't mean that, you know, rotary atomizer has been discarded. It is still used in the, and it is very robust, and it is still used in the dairy industry for the whey concentrate, thousands of droplets, and you can control the droplet size by changing the RPM of the wheel. And similarly, in this nozzle atomizer, the pressure energy is being used, you know. So So why MSD, you know, which I've already touched upon, one is a superior agglomeration, and in milk powders, you know, you need very good instant properties. So wettability and dispersibility, they are the parameters for the instant properties along with the coffee test. It has a coarse particles, so it's having good flowability. It is a three-stage drying, which leads to the low powder temperature during drying, so it's a low heat influence. It has much better heat economy as compared to single and two-stage dryers. It has the ability to handle highly thermoplastic products and high-fat products. And if you see the airflow and the geometry of the chamber, you know, the airflow is like, you know, when it comes from the top and also it is exhausted from the top, it has a natural sweeping action, you know. So it also in a way cleans the chamber walls, you know, while going up. So today, you know, MSD is proven and preferred dryer for the dairy and nutritional products, like all types of milk powder, even high protein powders, you know, like WPC, WPI, where the TS is much lower, you know, as compared to the milk while feeding to the dryer. High fat products, then high carbohydrate powders, and all the nutrition powders like infant formula and the special nutritional products. So this is how, you know, when we say how it is, how it produces very, you know, superior agglomerated powders. Now, I will just touch a little bit upon the theory, you know. So in any atomization, you know, there is a primary agglomeration, you know. So here, you know, I'm not retaining the fines from the cyclone or from the back filter. Even when the wet particles collide, you know, there is a primary agglomeration, you know. And then when the fines is introduced, you know, the fines is nothing but the powder which is recovered from the cyclones or from the back filter, which is again recycled back into the atomizing zone. Then, you know, there are some collisions between the dry and wet particles. And then the tertiary agglomeration is basically happening on the stratified bed, you know. So this is, you know, the final agglomeration stage, you know, where because in the stratified bed, you know, there is a powder layer and it gives enough retention time, you know, to have an intimate contact between the particles, whether they are semi-dried, wet and moist. So the complete agglomeration process, you know, completes in this in this static fluid bed, you know. So this is the animation, you know, you can see in a multi-stage dryer. First of all, you know, the geometry of the chamber is different. It has a short cylindrical heights and it has a, you know, higher conical length. This is the hot air which comes from the top. There is a disperser which ensures, you know, mixing of air, hot air with the droplets. And this is a static fluid bed. So the primary drying stage takes place in the cone itself. And the secondary drying stage is this static fluid bed where again, hot air is also passed. From the static fluid bed and from the chamber, it goes to the vibrofluidizer. In the vibrofluidizer, we have got the first stage again, which is a heating stage. So that's how we call it. Qualities as a three-stage drying system, and then the powder is is produced and conveyed to the powder handling silos or the storage silos and to the packing machines. The air is exhausted from the top, which has some fines powder, and then it is collected either into the back filter or to the cyclones. Collected, and then again it can return back to the atomizing zone. It can go to the static fluid bed. It can go to the first section of the vibrofluidizer, you know. And this flexibility is offered if you want powders of different bulk densities, you know, or different agglomeration. So important, very important, I would say the heart of the system, of course, we also talked about the nozzle atomizer and MSD, but the air dispersers, are also very, very critical, you know. And if you see a good mixing of the hot drying air with the spray of droplets is required for number one, control of air and particle flow, which is essential for effective spray drying operation with respect to the product quality and trouble-free operation. So over last few decades, you know, the air disperser with pressure nozzles creating the vertical downward airflow are being used. This type of disperser, you know, if you see this old disperser, it is typically equipped with numbers of perforated plates for securing a downward flow through which the long nozzles, you know, the feed nozzles, they protrude. But, you know, this type of arrangement, you know, it was resulting into high pressure drop and a difficult nozzle adjustment to obtain the optional agglomeration, you know. So with a common goal to have an even air distribution and nozzle assembly that minimize the powder deposits, having a interchangeable nozzles, low delta T, GIA developed a new duct type disperser, which you can see on the right hand side, which is called DDDT. It operates with a straight downward flow, but without the perforated plates. So the delta P is much, much lower, you know. So you can see this is how it operates. So one is, you know, the low delta P, uniform air distribution, but the one of the main advantages, like, you know, nozzles, lenses, you know, you can adjust from outside, you know, and this is how we adjust, you know, this is the fine cetern which is coming from the cyclones. This is a feed nozzle, and then you can vary the, you know, orientation of the nozzles to have more agglomerated powder or less agglomerated powder. And this is one of the main advantages of going for this duct type. The nozzle lenses are shorter and more easy to operate, you know, while the plant is under operation, you know. So this is a multi-stage dryer and overview. We have air disperser, then we have a nozzle stands. You can see nozzle rods inlets is a nozzle type atomizer. Then we have got this explosion membranes and then hammers and then the static fluid bed. Now, you know, when we talk about the explosion membranes, you know, safety is very, very critical. So I will just touch upon, you know, how, you know, there are fires and explosion, possible fires and explosion in a spray drying plant for milk powder, you know. Milk powder is a food product, you know, very nice to taste, but also, you know, potential powder air mixtures in the dryer can lead to fire and explosion also. So the large majority of fires in spray dryers, they originate from the lump formation, which is in the nozzles, around the nozzles. If there are frequent starts and stops, and if the nozzles are not cleaned properly, the lump is heated up and will at one point break up. And when the heated lump falls into the lower chamber areas, it will be exposed to the potential, you know, explosive dust air mixtures, and it represents the potent ignition source, you know. So all our spray dryers, you know, first of all, they have this fire water fighting system. Immediately, you know, when the temperature goes up, in event of any fire or explosion, the pressure goes up. And as a result, the temperature also goes up. And we have got all these set points to sprinkle the water whenever there is a fire or fire incident. And then, you know, we have this explosion vent, you know. Which is, you know, in case of any pressure built up, you know, this explosion vent is a part of the dryer. So it will just, if the pressure develops in the chamber, you know, it will just blow it off, you know, it will be exposed or exhausted to the atmosphere, you know. And this explosion vent is the weakest part, so that, you know, it will first break and it will protect the chamber from any physical damage. We also have, as you would have seen in the film on Amul Fed powder plant, we have this CO detection system also, which detects the CO content between the inlet air and the exhaust air. and depending upon the set point, you know, it will alert the operator, and then the fire water system can also start, you know. And then we also have explosion suppression system, you know. So it depends upon the levels of safety, you know, which we want to incorporate in the plant. So the second and the tertiary stage of the drying, it happens in the static fluid bed. You can see the photograph and the vibrofluidizer. And in the vibrofluidizer and the static fluid bed, we have this special type of flex plate, which helps in fluidization of the powders as well as drying of the powders at required velocities. And the product, you know, why it is vibro? Because you need some vibration for powder to travel from one end to another end, you know. So in a way, it passes through the first drying stage, then it is cooled in the last drying stage, or I would say the last stage of the vibrofluidizer, before it is either packed manually or it is taken to the powder silos. Cyclones are very important and very easy to understand. And of course, the objective is a part of the exhaust system, and the objective is to arrest the emission losses and to ensure that it conforms to the local legislation, and also to reduce the product losses as the fines recovered are recycled back to the atomizing zone of the sprayed air. So they are mostly used, you know, easy to maintain, no moving parts, easy to clean, fully welded construction. But then, if you see the basic principle is that, you know, powder and air, you know, which is coming out, the exhaust air, which is coming from the dryer, it passes tangentially into the cyclones at equal velocities, and they swirl in a spiral form down to the base of the cyclone. The centrifugal force here, it is predominant. So it acts to move the powder particles towards the cyclone wall, which is collected at the bottom, while the clean air spirals upwards along the central axis of the cyclone and then passes out at the top, you know, as a clean air. But here also, you know, GIA has done innovation and development, and they have come out with a new cyclone design, which is cyclone extra efficiency. If you see in the old designs, you know, the high velocity swirl, you know, it can cause two adverse situations, you know, either it can be attrition or smearing of the fat, you know, because the powder also has a fat contained, you know, whether it's a dairy powder or whole milk. So because of the pressure drop and because of the velocity swirl, you know, the fat can be smeared on the surface of the cyclones. So based on the CFDs and lab tests, you know, we developed a new design, which is cyclone extra efficiency, and which mitigates the risk of the attrition, thereby increasing the suppression efficiency, and also reduce the risk of the deposit formation and sparing, you know. So as compared to the old cyclones, you know, the cyclone yield is up to 70%, you know, of the old designs, more. And you can see from appearance point of view, the cyclones are much taller, slimmer, you know, as compared to the old cyclones. The back filter, you know, if you want still less emission losses, then you need to go for the back filter, which is fully CIPable. Your emission losses will be in the range of 10 to 20 milligrams per nm cube, you know. This is at least in the Europe, it is mandatory to go for this back filter. And before the year 2000, only cyclones were used, you know, as a primary separator, as no truly sanitary bag house filter was available. And here also, you know, GIA Nairo has developed a truly CIPable bag filter, you know, after decades of R&D and developmental in the year 1999, you know. So to meet the challenges of low emission, low OPEX, sanitary design with cleaning in place. You know. So if you see broadly, you know, it has a three sections. It is of reverse jet pulse. It means that, you know, when the when the bag filter is in operation, there is a reverse jet pulse going on to remove the powder which is formed on the outside of the bags. So it has a three sections. One is, you know, the middle section, which is the main section, bag filter section, with the exhaust air coming from the dryer, along with the internal and external CIP nozzles on the hold plate. A hold plate is holding the bags. Then at the top is your clean air plenum. And then the bottom is your conical bottom for product discharge through a fluidization. So during the operation, the product collected on the outside of the filter material, you know, is removed by a compressed air jet stream, you know, which is blown into the inside of each bag by means of a specially designed reverse jet nozzle, you know, which is positioned above the bag. CIP of this bag filter is undertaken after operation of 3 weeks, you know, depending, or two months, you know, in some of the installations, you know, the bag filter is taken for CIP after 2 to 3 months, you know, whereas if it is a dairy whitener or skim milk, you know, the frequency between two CIP is much lower. So these are basically, you know, main features of Senesip. Like, you know, the pulsing is with supersonic nozzles, sanitary design which allows for efficient de-dusting. Then polyester bags, you know, which are again developed by GIA. They are all FDA approved. They can withstand the temperature of 140 degrees centigrade. The design is as per USDA 3A as well as EHETG. And the benefits are, of course, you know, higher product recovery due to very low emission losses. So we have completed, you know, the evaporation plant, you know, for concentrating the milk, and then also the dryers, various types of dryers we discussed. We also discussed about, you know, the types of atomization, the types of air disperser, and also, you know, the exhaust recovery systems by cyclones and bag filters. So now once the powder is produced from the dryer, you know, and it needs to be packed, you know, the powder is of very good quality, fully agglomerated. So we also need a very gentle conveying of this powder, you know, to the powder silos. So this is how, you know, what we use in the conveying of the powder is a dense phase powder conveying system, you know, which means, you know, because I want to reduce the breakdown of the fragile powder, and it is highly agglomerated and I have to retain the instant properties, we need a very gentle conveying system, you know. So GIA also is a specialist in process and design know-how for this dense phase powder systems, which operate at very low velocity and higher powder to air ratios to reduce the product breakdown or damage. So we have got two types of dense phase powder system. One is, you know, the up conveying, which is a pressure dense phase system. And then other is the down conveying, which is, you know, the up conveying is basically, you know, the powder which comes from the dryer. It is collected to the powder silos. So this is a pressure dense phase conveying system. And from the silos, you know, when the silos are emptied out, the powder is conveyed to the packing machine. So that is through the vacuum dense phase conveying system. So in the industrial scale plants, you know, we have, as you can see in this small animation, you know, there's a vibrofluidizer of the dryer. Then there is a powder sieve to classify the powder and to remove the hard lumps, if there are any. It goes to this pressure pots. This operates under the plug flow. It goes to this powder silos, right? And this powder silos are with, you know, all these dust collectors, filters and other things. And from powder silos, from here, you know, it is vacuum conveyed, you know, to this vacuum hopper, and from here it goes to the packaging. This is how it runs. You know, there is a, since it is a vacuum dense phase in the town conveying, we also have a vacuum pump over here. So in that way, you know, the fragile powders, the agglomerated powders are retained, you know, so that the agglomerates are retained in the sense that, you know, the breakdown is minimal. So once we have conveyed the agglomerated powder to the powder silos, we have, you know, this powder needs to be packed, you know, and since this is a food product, you know, and the milk powder capacities are also growing much higher, you know, and we need a higher capacity, you know, packing rate. So Kia also has a 25 kg bulk packing line where it is fully automated with limited intervention of the operators. It's a bottom up filling so that, you know, the dusting is very less. There's a total bag control right from the start of the machine to the end. So it holds the top of the bag at all times. And it is a single integrated machine, you know, from the powder infeed to the sealed bag output, you know. So after the accuracy is really good in this machine. And then we have got these, all this, you know, downline equipment after the bag is packed, you know, for checking the weights, then, you know, metal detection system, the flattening system before it goes to the online metallic detection system, you know. So I just run a small clip on this packing machine. Now this this 25 kg bulk packing machine, there is also, you know, recent installations. In fact, we have two such installations at Banas Dairy as well as Amul Fat Dairy, and the packing rates are quite high, almost 8 tons per hour. And also it prompted different the new development, I would say, in the bags. It was because, you know, if you see the old bags, you know, we had this loose liner inside the craft bag, whereas for such automated machines we need a pre-glued bags, you know. So that was a change in the dairy industry. If you want to go for this highly automated hygienic bagging line from end to end, even the bags types were also changed. You know, you need to have a pre-glued craft bag with a liner inside. So I come to the last slide of my presentation. So apart from this 25 kg bulk packing, we also have a retail packing, and especially, you know, all this baby food powders, nutritional powders, they are also filled in this cans. So we have a range of this cans filling, you know, either by this auger filling as well as vacuum filling. So that also is within the Gia portfolio. So right from end to end, you know, whether it's a liquid milk processing, which my colleague Swati will cover in the second slot, then the evaporation plant, the dryer, the powder handling systems, and then the packing systems. So that completes, you know, the milk powder factory. So that finishes my presentation, Dr. Kele. How we are placed in the time? I mean, is there any question answer session now?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Or we have to go to the second slot, you know, if the time is running out.
Yes, sir. We have to directly move to the second slot. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Sir, any questions and all that, you know, I'm the most welcome, you know, after the second lecture is over, if we can have some time for question answer sessions, you know.
Okay, sir.
If the time permits, yeah.
Okay, sir. Okay. So thank you, sir, for such a wonderful presentation. It is, sir, our privilege from hearing from you.
See, this was basically a flavor, you know, a trailer, you know, in 1 hour. But I think, you know, the technologies which we offer, you know, whether it's a spray dryer, evaporation, powder handling and powder packing, you know, it takes, you know, almost 1 day for such discussions, you know. Because
but sir,
this is, you know, since you know, students are also there, you know, they should get a feel of overview of a milk powder plant and what are the critical things and to know about a milk powder plant, you know.
Yes sir, that's, yeah, very true. Due to the bars on the track, we weren't able to take it long.
Yeah,
we are very grateful to you, sir, for the coverage of the topic, sir, whether it is from the processing part, the baking part, or the microbial quality of the powder.
Yeah.
Sir, we express our heartiest thanks to you, sir, for being with us despite our busy schedule on the occasion of Engineers Day. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, it's our pleasure, and always we would like to be connected with academics and renowned universities like Parul. So always it will be, you know, these interactions should continue.
Sure, sir. It was a pleasure for us, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So I will stop sharing my screen right now.
Yes, sir. Okay. So it was a wonderful session. Now moving to the second session. Without any delay, let me introduce our second speaker, Dr. Chitranayak Sinha, sir. He is a senior scientist in the Dairy Engineering Department from the National Dairy Research Institute, Karnal. Before handing over to the Dr. Chitranayak, sir, let me introduce the sir. He completed his BSc in Electronics from the Bihar University. After that, he completed BE equivalent AMIT degree in 1993. And then after, he pursued his master's in 1995 from the Department of Electronic Science, Delhi University. And after completion of his
his M.Tech, he joined MTNL as a junior telecommunication officer in 1997, and in 2000 he joined as a scientist in the dairy engineering department at National Dairy Research Institute. And in 2017 he completed his PhD from NDRI Bangalore. So he has a vast experience of research, having 20 research papers published in the national and international journals, 12 projects completed, 5 book chapters published, and he has developed 4 technologies, and also he is guiding masters as well as PhD scholar. So I request Dr. Chitranayak sir to share his knowledge with us.
Many thanks, sir, for this nice introduction. And first of all, I will say namaskar, good afternoon to all the respected heads and seniors, and thanks for giving me the opportunity. And first of all, I want to say that after the presentation of Sri Rajesh ji of GIA, so exhaustive and so detailed presentation, I think I am nothing. My presentation will not match at all what sir has presented, the detailed explanation of the whole working of the plant. I am more related with associated with teaching, so some of basic concepts I will try to give, and I find myself very small and very small in the area of this automation and mechanization. Dairy plant and food plant is so big subject, so big and so exhaustive and so nice subject. So whenever I go for learning, I find so many new things. Every time I find so many new things. So I will try to cover a little some of basics what I could understand, and I will not tell that I am not at all any expert of this subject. I did not find myself expert. I am still a learner, and I know very little in this subject. So with this much word, should I start sharing my presentation, sir?
Yes, sir. You can start your presentation.
Okay, sir. Is it visible, sir? Sir, is it visible? My presentation is visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Should I, 1 second. आई एम सो सॉरी सर, मैं ले लूंगा, मैं कर लूंगा। जय भगवान जी को मिला दीजिए तो थोड़ा चले जाएंगे, थोड़ा या रंजीत के साथ में चले जाएंगे, रंजीत एंड जय भगवान जी। सो सॉरी सर। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, दिस मैकेनाइजेशन इन डेयरी प्रोसेसिंग प्लांट विथ ऑटोमेशन एंड इंस्ट्रूमेंटेशन, दिस इज वॉट आई वॉन्ट टू कन्वे दैट।
सॉरी,
हेलो
सर।
यस सर,
सर योर स्क्रीन इज नॉट विजिबल। Presentation is not visible.
Presentation is not visible.
No,
okay, I am resuming it. Okay. Is it visible, sir?
Yes, sir. Now it is visible.
Okay. Sorry for the disturbance. No, so many official work in between coming. Okay. So first, I will introduce myself. I am Chitra Nayak in Dairy Engineering Division of ICAR NDRI. I am working as a senior scientist in dairy engineering. So whatever mechanization is taking place in the country in the plants, so those are helping in processing the milk and getting the best product out of the milk, whatever we are producing, whatever our farmers are producing throughout the country. And in those, I can say that we are using different kinds of instruments, sensors, control instruments, and field instruments. And in all those, we find different kinds of instruments, and different kinds of all the instruments are working with different principles. So here, whatever work we are doing, we need certain parameters for all the process. So those parameters, we are not here for qualitative analysis. We are here for quantitative analysis. If we are giving some operation to certain limit, like boiling of milk up to 90 degree. So it is not that we should guess that now temperature has reached. We have to give the certain value that now 90 degree has reached. So for that objective evaluation, we need every time certain kind of instruments, certain kind of sensors, which will sense the parameter and it will reflect the value at the output as display. So this is the method, this is the instrument, this is the principles we are every time using. Even Lord Kelvin sir has told, our great Lord Kelvin, that when we are measuring something, we are speaking something about, we should express it in numbers. Then we can say that we are knowing about that parameter. We are knowing about that process variable. So if we are able to express that in number, that in digits, that in value, so quantitative evaluation, then we are knowing that variable. We are controlling. If we know the variable, we can control it, we can monitor it. So for those reasons, we need certain kind of instruments, and most of the instruments are working on the basic physics principles, magnetic principles, and all the different principles given by our old scientists, earlier scientists, and new scientists. All research are going on, and different instruments are coming on. So now, coming to Indian position, what milk is being produced here? India stands first in the milk production and reached this position in 1997. And it produces about 18.5% of total milk production. So we can say that India has about 2.4% of land and produces about 18.5% of total milk. So, and in 2014, India produced higher milk than entire European countries. And now you see that milk production in year 2016-17 was 165.4 million ton, and increased by 6.6% to reach to 176 million ton, and it reached in 2018-19 to 187. Oh, one at both places has been deleted. 187.75 million ton, and it was only 50 to 61. The development rate was very low, about 1.6%, but. You can say that in comparison to 1991 to 1992, milk production was 55.6 million ton, which reached up to 187.75 million ton in 1819. So about more than three times in less than three decades. So this is the effort by dairy farmers, and this much milk we have handled with the efforts of improved technologies and dairy plants. And this is also what I have told earlier, which is last 4 years, 155 million ton in 15-16, and 16-17, 165.4 million ton. And 2017-18, it is 176.3 million ton milk. And now it has reached to 187.7 million ton in 2018-19. This is the last data we had. And milk gram per liter per person also increased slowly, 337 to 394 gram per liter per person milk availability in the India. So we are seeing that by the processing improvement in the milk processing techniques and preservation technique, we are handling this much amount of milk in the country. So this is not a means easy job, and it could become possible with the sincere effort, sincere labor of the Indian dairy farmers as well as our dairy plant processing people. And 10 highest milk producing states in India, UP, Rajasthan, Gujarat, these are the million ton production in these states. And these are varying, actually. These are these all are 1 year old data. So these are changing sometimes. Seven position is going to eight or increasing every year. So, and now I come to my topic, mechanization. So we have seen that India is producing so much of milk and highest milk producing country. So how this much milk is being preserved, how this much milk is being consumed by the people, how it is being handled from people from rural area to city area, urban area. So this all are being done by the sustained production system. So to make it a beneficial and to make it as a business, we have to make it sustainable production system. Sustainable production system means if we are getting it as a business, it as a profitable business, then it will be sustaining. And now it is sustaining and retaining the top position by the continuous growth and continuous and sincere effort of our government, our processing people, our plant, our milk cooperatives. So by that way, we can make it a commodity driven agribusiness. And we are seeing that our milk processing plant, those are depending on the livestock sector very much, because whatever milk is being produced by cow, cattle and buffalo and camel, goat. So our whole production is depending on the livestock sector as well. So mechanization for milk production and milk handling as well as to livestock sector is also essential part. So for example, milking machine, it is directly connected to cow and buffalo. Fodder handling system, feeding machines, harvesting system, milk processing. We are in milk processing more. We are knowing more about milk processing, but livestock sector and machine and mechanization in livestock sector is equally important. And by that improvement, only milk processing will be depending. Both will complement each other. That I want to say. And now, what is mechanization? That we want to say that. We will come to our topic of mechanization or plant processing systems. So mechanization is basically either replacing or assisting or doing away the animal or human labor in farming by mechanical power wherever is possible. Means instead of human labor, we are using power of machine. Machine is working instead of people or human. Like tractor is being used in plowing the field. Earlier, bulls were being used in plowing the field. So mechanization may, there are two kinds of mechanization. either partial or complete. If some part is being replaced, it is partial. If complete part is being done by machine, it is completely mechanized system. Now we will compare manual system, manual processing control, and automatic control system. In mechanization, there are two kinds of control. Something is being controlled manually. Initially, when mechanization started, some machines were used by people. The thinking decision taking person and thinking human brain was the thinking and controller. Human brain was the controller who was seeing the situation by using certain machines, by certain sensors, and after, based on the process parameters, process values, he was taking the decisions whether they should operate it or control it or switch off the operation, like that. So human brain was controller and taking actions, control actions. So those were manually operated switch or manually operated actuators. So that was in manual process control. After that, automatic control system has come, in which instead of person, see this in this example, we want to say show that this is the heat exchanger in which we are supplying hot water for some process, say for a rinsing process of entire dairy plant. We need around 60 degree temperature of hot water that is coming out. So a person who is standing here, he is watching the thermometer every time. He is watching the thermometer every time, and as and when temperature is high, it will close the steam flow. Whatever steam is flowing in this this heat exchanger, so it will close the valve if temperature is going up, going above the 60 degree. If it is maintaining 60 degree, steam will be flowing on and cold water is coming from this side. So this process is being controlled manually. Person is standing here watching every time this thermometer reading, this thermometer sensor is inserted with this output flow of hot water. So this is manual system. A person is involved continuously to monitor the hot water output and then operating the valve accordingly. So this is manual system. So if one or two operation, a person can be deployed there to monitor the variable and operate the system. But for 100 system, 100 person cannot be employed to operate this way. So for that reason, automatic controller has come, in which this sensor is sensing in the same fashion, and this is giving command to this controller. Controller has a comparator where the set value of 60 degree, what 60 degree we needed here, that same 60 degree value as a set value or reference value has been inserted in this controller. So controller will compare with this sensor output with the set value. What set value, reference value we inserted in this controller will be compared with the sensor output. If it is 60 degree, the steam flow will continue. If it is above 60 degree, the steam flow will be cut. So that decision will be taken by controller on the basis of this controller sensor output and the reference input what we give. So this is the automatic system. So no need to deploy a person to monitor the sensor output every time and operate the actuator every time. So by this method, we are nowadays this control system working. So this is the basic concept what I wanted to tell. So this is the automatic control system. When this started it about in 1947 by General Motors, and feedback control system started in 1930, and automation has been achieved by various means, including there are so many things: mechanical system, hydraulic system, pneumatic electrical system, electronic system, computers have come. So slowly the things have become modern and sophisticated. So and application is huge in on including our dairy processing plant to all the system, aeroplane, automobile, factory, modern factories, so many applications. And in our processing plant, we need to operate equipment by controlling from steam supply from boiler to heat treating ovens, switching in telephone networks, steering, stabilizers, ships, aircraft. Means there are various and means uncountable number of applications where this basic concepts of automations is being reduced to reduce the human labor and human interventions. And what are the use when we are applying in this automation? By that we can reduce the human interventions, and it saves labor, energy and materials. It saves labor, energy and materials. But one thing is that only one lacune or only one negative point of automation is that it reduces labor, so certain kinds of employment is being lost, we can say. But at the same time, it employs more number of machines. So a person who is taking training in more number of machines can get a job in those area. So, and another thing is that by the application of automation, human interventions are restricted. So quality of the product is improved, and by automated system, reference value or set value we are giving, the throughout the production system, it is not varying. Output is not varying. Output will be fixed. So, but in a human working system, by human variation of operation, there are so many variations in the output. But in automated system, output is fixed. So accuracy and precision is very high in case of automated production system. And in there are two kind of system of control system. In one is sequential system, where a particular program is fed and the output is produced in sequential manner. It is not getting any output from feedback from any output. So there is no change. Only one command will be given and it will work on that sequence. So this is a sequential system. It is a kind of elevator lift. It is in a sequential system, right? What command we have given, 7th floor we want to go. It will go in a sequence to 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 7th floor. But in a feedback control system, every time feedback is given, like what I have shown earlier in our control system, feedback from the sensor is being given to controller. And a controller has a set value and comparator. It compares the set value with the sensor output and then gives the command to a final control element. So this is a advanced automation system which works on feedback control system. So now most of the control systems are working, automated control systems are working on the basis of feedback control techniques. So now we see, this is the repeat of this figure. This is manual system. This is a feedback control system. Feedback is coming from this output to controller, and then controller compares the set value with the sensor output and giving command to actuator. Actuator is the final control element which will get command from this controller and work accordingly. If controller tells it's on, so it will be on and steam supply will be going on. This is hydraulic system, and steam supply is being given to this heat exchanger system. And the same process is being shown in a block diagram. The same automatic control system is in this process. The cold water is coming in and hot water is coming as a output. This hot water is coming as an output, and temperature sensor is monitoring this temperature. Temperature sensor is being monitored by the temperature. So this controller will compare with this sensor output with our set point of 60 degrees centigrade, that whether this is maintaining 60 degree centigrade or deviating. If it is maintaining 60 degree centigrade, it will say, give command to this actuator that okay, 60 degree is maintained, you supply the heat so that water will be heating. If it is above 60 degree, it will cut, it will switch, it will give command to switch off the, or stop the steam flow. So that, and this steam flow is known as manipulated variable, which is manipulating the temperature of this controlled variable. Temperature of this water is controlled variable, which we want to maintain every time at the set value. This temperature controlled variable of the temperature of water, which we want to maintain throughout the processing of the system. So this is the entire concept of this automated control system on the feedback based automated control system. So this is the basic concept what I wanted to give in my work. So after those basic concept, what are the applications? We have seen that in the last 20-30 years. Earlier means we have seen that in 1947, after 47 General Motors and all the different departments, they have initiated this application of this automation, and electronic advancements have been implemented in those plants. But in our food and dairy, we have initiated much later. In last 20 years, we have not seen any packaged food before 20 years. In 80s, 90s, hardly we were finding any packaged food. But in I can say after 95 or in 2000, this application of this automated system have been implemented in our processing plants, food processing and dairy processing, and the application of electronics and computer technologies have significantly pushed forward the progress of automation in the food processing industry. And the research development applications of computerized have improved the food quality and its evaluation. And in this food processing system, we encountered with various processing variables like temperature, pressure, flow, humidity, consistency, viscosity. So we are encountered with different kinds of control system for these parameters, different kinds of sensors for these parameters, temperature sensor, pressure sensors, flow sensors, humidity sensors, viscosity sensors, and measurement of, for measuring these kind of different kind of instruments for temperature measurement, pressure measurement, flow measurement, different instruments we are encountered and we are developing. So we are having so many instruments for these process variable measurement. So with the these advancements, we are able to now produce top quality of milk and products with our Indian techniques and Indian instruments. And with these advancement in technology, automatic process control minimize the human interventions, due to which the chances of contaminations have been reduced in the processed food items. Now, same thing is being that automation reduces the drudgery of the people. And in automation, if we are we want to place in a harsh condition, if a machine is working, but a person cannot stand, like in a 200 degrees near a blast furnace or near a harsh condition climate, machine can be placed there and it can give the good reading, it can work on the mechanized system, automated system. A person cannot stand there. So it reduces, eliminates the drudgery and harshness of the people. It removes, it controls. So instead of placing a person, it is better a machine can work the work there, and eliminates the difficulty of a human, and quality can also be improved by that. And by employing the sensors and transducers, we have to design what kind of sensors and transducers should be employed in those instrumentation system, which will sense the required parameter only, and it should not change any unrequired change in the the product. So those kind of sensors and transducers are being employed and being developed. And now we are seeing that, like for one cattle, one or two cattle, we can milk by hand. But for 100 cows, 100 buffaloes in a dairy farm, we need to have some automated and some machine system. So, for example, we are having this milking machine, which is having this vacuum pump and vacuum pipeline, and then milk cooling system tank, like 30-40 liter if one cow or buffalo is producing. So we need to keep it in a cold system, because if 100 cows and 100 buffalo we are milking, so it will take 3-4 hours in collecting the milk. So by 3-4 hours we cannot keep milk in open. So we need certain cooling system at that place only. So these are the system which has been developed for farm level application. So now I come to the milk collection at dairy processing plant. How methods are being followed? How mechanization system have improved the system? Normally, what happens that our cooperative milk cooperatives are providing milk BMCs at farm level, where individual farmers are giving their milk produced to the dairy farmers located near the milk collection center. They are bringing milk to milk collection center at village level, at farm level. And one contractor, and they are collecting milk from individual milk producers, supplied to the dairy plant. And cooperative organizations, they are providing these BMCs at a farm level, so that to avoid the milk middleman, so that farmers can get direct money from the cooperatives, and farmers can get the benefit of their produced milk. So this is the system. And BMC storage has been, whatever milk is stored at BMC, that double jacketed tankers, tankers are being used to bring the milk from village to dairy plant, cooperative plant, where its quality, fat, SNFA are being checked, and then in plant, those milk collection center, all the qualities has been verified, and then it is being taken into plant for further processing. Now I want to tell that when milk is being milked after coming from the udder of animal, it is completely sterilized. It has no bacteria. But as and when it comes to environment, it is getting infected and contaminated. So bacteria multiply if it gets temperature at around 20-25-30 degrees centigrade. At around 4 degrees centigrade, this we can see this graph of red color. At 4 degrees centigrade, the multiplication of bacterial multiplication rate is very, very low. So whenever we are using any BMC and all the centers, we may want to maintain 4 degrees centigrade, because at 4 degrees centigrade, this multiplication of bacteria multiplication rate is very, very low. We can say that it is negligible. And in our Indian climate, temperature remains around 30 degrees centigrade, 30, 25 and above. So multiplication of this bacterial rate is very, growth rate is very high. So we want to maintain it at 4 degrees centigrade. So milk chilling is very, very important operation for all the dairy plant and BMC. And this is the silo where milk is being preserved in the plant, and dairy plant milk line. This is the all what we want to show, and we want to describe the milk processing and mechanization, how it is improving the milk quality, milk preservation, shelf life, milk preservation, and different products production. So this is the whole mechanization of plant, working system, milk conveying system, how milk is being packed and being conveyed, and Now I will come to SCADA. SCADA is a process, automation and mechanized system. It is supervisory control and data acquisition system. In a large plant, like as you see, the plants are situated in 1 kilometer area, 2 kilometer area, like big plants like Amul, Nandini, and Sudhas. So big plants. So it needs to be controlled, supervisory control is required. So this is done by SCADA system. This system is known as SCADA, where all the different located processes are being monitored by the sensors, and those are known as RTU, remote terminal units are placed at field means where the actual processing is taking place. So sensors are placed at different locations, and they are sending commands to human interface center, where control panel, where all the control systems are there, where people and engineers are sitting, and in their monitor whole system, whole plant layout is being shown, and he can see that this is red button where the parameter is going above the limit. So he can send command from sitting at his control panel. He can send command alarm system to that. The person in that remotely located unit, RTU, he can get the value. Okay. We can control. We have to control it. So, and this whole is being done by communication network is the channel which is flowing the data from RTU to human machine interface. RTU, remote terminal unit, is collecting data from the different locations and giving it to human machine interface at the center place, control panel. And control panel is watching the entire plant at his screen and giving control command back to the control unit. Okay, it is working correct, green signal. If it is not working correct, red signal. So accordingly, this SCADA system is working. It may be a different size, 20 kilo input output, 450 kilo input output, different means large units, big units are being worked on a SCADA system. So now most of the dairy plants, big dairy plants like this, they all are working on SCADA. Like all silos, they are having this load cell based pressure sensors here. This command is being shown in this SCADA system at the control panel. This load cell value is being shown in the SCADA. This being shown, all are connected through this communication channel, and the values are being shown on the control panel screen at HMI, human machine interface, at control panel screen at the manager's room, engineer's room, who is getting all the command from all the values from these sensors to his screen, and giving command accordingly. So this is the SCADA system, and this is flexible and open architecture. This is a machine man machine interface. It is having alarm handling and trading capability, access control, automation systems are there. Interface with two hardware and software. So this is a whole big plants are employing this SCADA concept of working. And this is automation control system, this is a material handling system, this is milk bottle filling system of this small setup, and this is a PLC kit, and this is water bottling system in automation method, and this is the application of automation control system. This what is the goal of automation system is to give the best quality. This again a small thing what we have already discussed, that set point or what exact value we want to maintain, that is a set point. So this is one example again, temperature monitoring and maintaining, controlling by this set point value by this is the controller. So the same thing, how value is being manipulated and controlling in this heating system. And this is a heat exchanger control system. Here, this is the process, heat exchanger, and this sensor is placed at this system, and this is a temperature controller and temperature transmitter system, which is where we are giving the set point value, and this is the actuator and the valve, which is to be maintained and controlled by this controller system. Same thing in different way, different systems are there, but concept is almost similar. This is also the feedback control system, where feedback is given by this sensor, which is a transmit temperature value is being transmitted to temperature controller, which is giving a control signal to this actuator. This is the valve actuator, which is final control element, which is controlling the supply of steam to this heat exchanger system. So this is also level control system. In the same automatic control system, it is working like in silo. If silo is full, this is the output. It will give control level controller system, and then it will sensor will give the value, and level controller will give command level transmitter. So this is also a control system, feedback control system. And that same block diagram, controller is giving command to final control element. This is the process where sensor is there placed in the output, and sensor is giving value to feedback amplifier, which is generating this feedback amplifier, generating and amplifying the, because sometimes this comparator has very small value, sensor has very small value. So those values is to be amplified by this amplifier, and this error signal is being given to controller. Controller will feed the set value or reference value in this controller, and which controller will give command to this actuator. Actuator, what we have shown as a valve, which is final control element, and this final control element will operate the process. Steam or something, steams to be given up to process or not, that will be decided by this controller based on the, after comparing the set value with the output of this sensor. So this is all the about the control. This is control panel where the person is sitting, is monitoring whole the plant. And now I want to say in the last, that during the lockdown, whole country has faced so many problems, so many scarcity, but throughout the country, nowhere milk scarcity has been felt. So our people have talked of so many things about corona warriors, doctors, police. So I want to salute our dairy processing people who have confirmed the supply of milk throughout the country in this harsh and lockdown situation. So they are also they also should be praised how they have managed the entire plant, and milk was supplied throughout the country. And in this lockdown period also, scarcity of milk was not reported in any corner of the country. So that was our automated developed plant system and milking system. So this all I wanted to say. And with this all, I want to complete my presentation. Nowadays means Hindi days. Yesterday was Hindi days. Today is Engineers Day. So with this combination, I want to say this dhanyavad, and thanks to all the organizers who have taught me, and I find myself very small person, and I have not so much of exposure to the area, but what with little knowledge I wanted to give. And Vijay ji, finish. Thank you Vijay ji, and all the organizers, and Dhruvin Patel, all I want to thank, and all the senior people listening and sharing my views, I want to thank, and I want to give my regards to all of them. Thank you sir,
it was a very wonderful presentation. We enjoyed a lot listening to you, as well as your presentation was very indeed theoretical, knowledgeable, and all the attendees giving us very good feedback also, that your presentation was very good. You conveyed your topic very well on the mechanization in dairy process plant with automation and instrumentation. So on behalf of our department, on behalf of Parul University, we are very, very much appreciate your concern that from your busy schedule, you took some time for us and present your knowledge, present your thoughts with us. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. I find a little, really, I am telling you, I have heard so many experts. They have great knowledge, but I find very, very small in this area. And you have given us chance. I am grateful to you all, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank
also,
you.
Also, sir, to Dr. Chitranayak, sir, as well as Mr. Rajesh, sir, we would like to apologize for inconvenience at the initial of our session due to the connectivity error, sir.
No, sir, it's a common, sir. It's every time I miss so many presentations and webinar we are attending. It is happening, sir, because net problem and so many things are there. So thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It is common, sir. It's,
sir, as they say, after every dryness, die follows the tenderness. Sir, your session as well as Mr. Rajesh, sir, session was very well. So it gives us the tenderness of freshness and we would very much like to hear you from the future, sir, in future also. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Dr. Kele ji, thank you so much for your nice words and it was a very nice presentation and brilliant presentation from Dr. Chitranayak. In the meantime, I was just going through some questions, from the audience. And if you permit me, if the time permits me, I would like to answer, some of the questions, which the audience have put in the chat box,
Sure, sir. It was our pleasure.
Yeah, so one of the question was on the CIP regime, how do you do the cleaning of, the milk powder plant? And I have just found out some of the slides so that, the audience is also very clear, And that's what, I would just like to share the screen, yes. Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I think when we talk about the challenges, you can go for the best technology, you can go for the best plant, the best practices. Ultimately, cleaning regime plays a very, very important role. To ensure that the powder quality is okay, smoothness, or I would say smooth free operation, and other things. So I will just touch upon a little bit on the CIP. But when we talk about the evaporation plant, and this is all based on the process know-how and the experience and expertise of our process specialists, who are sitting in France, for this evaporation plant. So they've got decades and decades of experience. And when we talk about evaporation plant, we have got these steps, like rinsing, then pre-caustic, caustic dosing, caustic circulation. And then you can see, different parameters are there, for effective CIP regime, Now, if you see in a calendar tube, you've got two different layers, One is, of course, the first layer is a very spongy deposit, which consists of protein matrix with encapsulated calcium phosphate and milk fat, so this is very easy to remove. But then, the second layer, which is just on the inner surface, that is all mineral layer, so that's what, you need a good CIP regime with caustic and then acid and other things, Now, one trick is normally, we go for this 1.5% concentration, for cleaning. The pre-caustic, if you do it at 1.5%, we have seen that, if the concentration is higher, the deposits will be transported or it will be converted into a kind of gel, which is very difficult to dissolve afterwards. So normally we do the pre-caustic at lesser percentage, and then we go to the next step of caustic dosing at 1.5%. So this is all, I won't go into the details, the entire CIP regime is there, which is based on experience for cleaning of the evaporation plant. When we talk about the chamber, we have this the CIP nozzles are there, which are located in the ducts, in the cyclones, the evaporation plant needs to be CIP'd every 20 hours. The feed section, which is a wet section to the dryer, that also needs to be CIP'd every 20 hours. Of course, now we have this 24/7 milk powder plants at Amul Fed and Banas. So for that, we need to go for two sets of evaporation plant, two sets of feed section, and two sets of nozzle atomizer, to ensure that the plants are run 24/7. But coming to a normal plant where the evaporation plant is cleaned every 20 hours, the feed section to the dryer is cleaned every 20 hours. But when we talk about the wet cleaning of the chamber, it depends upon the product transfer, whether if there is a product transfer from say skim milk to whole milk or whole milk to dairy whitener, then of course wet cleaning of the chamber is required. But if it is a single product, running for a few weeks, and then the wet cleaning comes once in a month or once in 2 months, So there, the ducts are provided with the CIP nozzles, the cyclones are provided with the CIP nozzles, and the chamber is cleaned by the cleaning turbine. And this is how you can see, the CIP nozzles are of a special design, and they are all retractable type. So they are all fitted along the ducts and the chamber, on the cyclone and the VF. And you can see, when the CIP liquid is pumped, this particular nozzles comes out, cleans the surfaces, and then again it is flushed with the surface when the plant is under operation. So it is a very sanitary design, of CIP nozzles. So that, I can, second question was on the DSI, that was a very important question too, along with the CIP regime. And see, there are time temperature changes induced in the milk, and of course the milk is pasteurized in the liquid milk plant, but then again, we have some sort of pasteurization also in the pre-treatment, pre-heating section in the evaporation plant. So if you see, the milk chemistry, below 70 degrees centigrade, mainly all are reversible reactions. But above 70 degrees centigrade, they're all irreversible reactions. And what are the processes? What are the process changes, takes place when you heat the milk, One is, of course, the denaturation of whey proteins, then calcium phosphate precipitation, chemical changes in casein micelles, color development, off-flavor development, and bacteria kill. The main objective of going for this heat treatment is mainly from the bacteria kill point of view. And then if you see all these six, seven changes which happen, during the heat treatment, the time is very important, and only for the bacteria kill, temperature is important. So the idea is to go for a very short time for preheating, and that's where there's a swirl heater. There's a direct steam injection. If you can see the slide, the steam is filtered of a very good food grade quality. That is directly heating the incoming milk. Then you have got the holding tubes. So depending upon the product and depending upon the time temperature profile you would like to go for, the holding tube, they are available in 30 seconds, 60 seconds, 180 seconds. For high heat powder, you can go for higher temperature. But most of the dairies, they go for 105 degrees centigrade or at 5 seconds, to avoid denaturation of protein, So this is how the DSI system works, And this, the temperature profile of the entire evaporation plant, you can see the milk comes at around 5 degrees centigrade. It gets heated in the preheating section, direct contact type up to 45 degrees centigrade. From 45 to 70, again, direct contact type for avoiding this bacterial growth, thermophiles. Then it goes to this heat treatment, depending upon the product, it can range from 90 to 105, and then the holding is there, and then this is a temperature profile, you know, as you go along the calendar years. That's it. So I think these two main questions were there, which I have already answered.
So thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. Both the speakers have shared their knowledge on the occasion of Engineers Day. So we would like to deeply appreciate your concern that you share very well in the presentation. It was a wonderful presentation. It will be helpful for the attendees also for their advancement of the future. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Our pleasure. Yeah.
For attendees, the feedback form will be shared in the second session, and the second session will start sharply at 2 p.m. Okay. So thank you very much, attendees also, for attending the webinar. So we will ending this first session. I am requesting all the panel members they can leave the session. Thank you very much, sir. The second session will start at 2 p.m.